Welcome to NOAA Live Alaska. My name is Lisa Hiruki-Raring and I'm going to be moderating today's webinar. This series is a collaborative effort by NOAA Fisheries Alaska Fisheries Science Center, where I work, NOAA's Alaska Regional Collaboration Network, and NOAA's National Weather Service. I also wanted to introduce my co-coordinators, Story Oates and Mabel Baldwin Schaefer, who will be helping me behind the scenes. This webinar series is designed to help you get to know NOAA's work in Alaska, our partners and the communities we work with in Alaska, and how we connect with their communities. NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, studies the ocean and the atmosphere and where the two meet, from weather to ocean to the animals that live around us. This school year, we're presenting short series of webinars that are more regionally based so that we can focus on topics of interest to those regions of Alaska. We're aiming to present perspectives from the communities we work with, as well as research conducted by students and established scientists. We hope this gives you a look at different communities, as well as different career paths you might be interested in. Today, we're presenting the second webinar in our series for the Bering Strait. We had taken a couple weeks break because of the Iditarod and because of March Madness with basketball tournaments. And so we'll be starting with, we'll have our second webinar by Iñuraaq Kaylene Evans, who is the Communications Director for Native Movement and an alumnus of the Caleb Scholars Program. While we'll be talking about NOAA's and partners' roles in research and stewardship, we want to recognize that we're all coming to you from the traditional lands of Indigenous communities who have substantial traditional and local Indigenous knowledge and much to share with us. Iñuraaq is presenting this webinar from Denaina Elena in Anchorage, the ancestral land of the Denaina, who have stewarded this land for thousands of years. The community thrives thanks to their continued sharing of vision, wisdom, values, and leadership. We'd also like to acknowledge that we're hosting this webinar from the traditional lands of the Coast Salish, including the First People of Seattle, the Duwamish people, past and present. A few guidelines before I hand you over to our speaker. You're all muted because we have a lot of people on the line and we want to make sure everyone can hear our speaker. However, there's a box where you can write questions and we encourage you to ask them as we go, and my colleagues Story and Mabel and I will be keeping track for Iñuraaq. She'll stop every now and again and answer a few questions. We may not get to all of our questions, but we'll try to answer as many as we can. And I also wanted to remind folks that we sent out a bingo activity handout via email yesterday to everyone who registered for the webinar. So if you want to play during the webinar, make sure that you have the bingo card close by. And if you didn't see it on email, you still have a chance to download it, because we also uploaded it into the handout section of the webinar platform here. So if you go over to your control panel, there should be a section that says handouts, and you should be able to download it from there. Okay, I'll hand it over to Iñuraaq to introduce herself.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for your patience while I was finding the unmute button. I am Kaylene Iñuraaq Evans. I am from Sitnasauk, and my presentation is on Inupiaq values, being on the land, and always learning. Uvunga atiga Iñuraaq, Sitnasauk amulgu runga, Inupiaq runga, Higita gamilu katiak milu ilutka, mamaga agayuk, papaga kiok, Anaga Iñuraaq and Muktoya and Papaga Apav. My name is Kaylene, but my traditional name is Iñuraaq. I'm named after my maternal grandmother, Iñuraaq Myrtle Wells. She's from Katiaq, which is now known as Kayana. And although she had passed away in 2013, in our Inupiaq spirituality, in our way of belief, we have a really high value on our names. And so our traditional names are usually given after someone has passed or someone who is really beloved of the parents. And when they have a baby, they name them, and that the baby shares a spirit with the name, name of the person that they're with. They're called a tings, or atik is a namesake, someone you share a name with and then you share a spirit with. And so I'm the granddaughter of Myrtle Wells, and she is also Iñuraaq. So in the last 5 years, I've been more publicly introducing myself and going by Iñuraaq, and that allows me to keep my connection with my Ana close and to really honor her spirit in the ways that I want to carry the traits that she had. She was very loving and funny. She loved to laugh and was real generous. So when I honor my Inupiaq name and decide to introduce myself as Iñuraaq, that's how I would like to show up. And I'm also the granddaughter of the late Laura Matoya Sockpick Evans. She's from Kigitak, which is now known as Shishmaref. And her Inupiaq name was Muktoya, and she recently passed away last spring. And the baby I'm holding is also named Muktoya. So although my gram is gone from this physical realm, I get to still love her and love her spirit through my family members that carry her name, Muktoya. And as I mentioned, we welcome classrooms and adults to participate in the bingo sheet on Indigenous Inupiaq values. So you could follow along. I'll be naming values throughout this presentation, and you can check them off on your bingo sheet. And there's also a few subsistence foods that are also on the sheet. So when you see them in my pictures, you can check them off and let us know in the chat when you make a bingo. And so a couple of these values that I've already mentioned is respect for elders and respect and love for children. And my puppy is whining, but hopefully she'll entertain herself. Her name's Nuna, which is the land. So the land is being very present with us. I am born and raised in Nome. Traditionally known as Sitnisawak, or the Kuwerik region, which is home to Inupiaq, Siberian Yupik, and Yupik people. And I am the daughter of Bobby Evans Kiok of Nome and Kathleen Agayuk Jaycox of Kayana, Katiak in the Kotzebue region. And I graduated with a bachelor's in 2017 from the University of Hawaii and a master's in 2020. And so here are some photos of Sitnisawak, the land that I grew up on, that I had the opportunity to be raised within and to have a really deep connection to the land and to the respect for nature and the sila ilam, which is the weather. And it's so powerful. These are, of course, really nice photos in summertime, but up north, the winters can be very cold and the wind can change and the weather can change very drastically, very quickly. So we are taught to really respect the power of nature and the power of our environment, and that we really are so fortunate that the earth gets to decide whether we live or not in some instances, and we've been very protected and actually really given abundance from the earth, and it's so generous through our practice of subsistence lifestyles. I'd like to stop just as a, for a couple of minutes, if there are any questions so far.
Okay, thank you, Iñuraaq. And if you have any, I'd like to encourage our viewers, if you have any questions for Iñuraaq, please put them into the question box and we'll see whether we can answer any of them. And we did have one question about what is your favorite thing about your homeland, about where you grew up?
My favorite thing is boating or being on the water in our community. We have lots of rivers and the open ocean. And so boating has always just been one of my favorite activities.
another question that we had was, you said that you were named after your grandmother, and that's very important in your culture. And the question was, how who decides what to name new babies, in which family member to name a baby after?
Yeah, that's a great question. So it could change from family to family or from community to community, but it's often the eldest family member, like a grandmother or a grandfather or great grandmother, great grandfather, will want to choose a name. Sometimes babies will be born or they'll be named after someone who had recently passed away around the same time that the baby was born. And that's a way that we want to really keep a name and a spirit alive. So while maybe their physical body has left this earth, we could still pass their spirit along to the babies. And it's really beautiful because we'll think about our relationship. So for example, my gram, her name was Muktoya. And so now I have a little cousin who is also named Muktoya, but I can call her my gram because she carries the same name as my grandma. And so we also can practice those same relationships, which might seem a little silly or maybe a little confusing, but it's a way that we can just keep showing our love to someone, even though they may have passed on.
That's very nice. I really like that thought of passing on spirit and the connection from one generation to another. I know you have more that you want to share with us, so let's try to go to the next section and see what we have.
Okay, so growing up in Nome, I was very fortunate to practice a subsistence lifestyle. And subsistence is a very common word in Alaska, and it could be really simplified as a way of life. That this is just the way that we organize our time. This is the way that we organize our relationship to the land, is having this deep respect for the land and for animals, because everything has a spirit. And we're so lucky that animals will share their lives with us to feed us and nurture us as humans. And because they're so generous in giving themselves to us, we need to be very generous in the way that we share our resources and share the animals that we harvest with our family, with our elders, with widows or people who might not be able to hunt or gather the same way that we could. And so we have just a really beautiful way of living through subsistence practices. And we have, we get to learn a lot of skills and values such as hard work and cooperation and hunter skills. So here, these are photos of moose hunting. My dad and my brother is in one photo and myself and my partner is in the other. And we have the moose hanging in our smokehouse. And if you can see, there's the moose flag, but then also above it, we have salmon strips as well. We also are very lucky to gather berries and greens from our tundras. We're real abundant with berries like ukpiks and salmon berries, cranberries, blueberries. And the best thing about subsistence is you do it with your friends or you do it with your family, and you spend a lot of time together just having fun. And that's one of our values of humor, of just wanting to have fun and to be in good spirits while we're practicing. And so Nome, we're also able to harvest a lot of salmon. We're able to do it through rod and reel or through setting a net and or seining. So a few photos of salmon. And like I had mentioned, subsistence also teaches us that's how we learn, is through practicing. And so it starts where everyone goes as a part of the family. And as little as my siblings in these photos, you start very young. And sometimes before you're even tough enough to reel in the fish, you still have that fun and you still get to be a part of the action of it. And as you get older and you grow up, then you can take on more responsibility and to understand the deeper connection to our resources and to our environment. And so we get to also really learn about sharing and sharing the knowledge that it takes, sharing the knowledge of fishing spots or the process of cutting up a fish or drying it or smoking it. It's just a really fun way to learn because you're doing it together with people and it's out on the land and it's so interactive, you know, and you get to learn also like your responsibility and your role within a family and how, like myself as an older sibling, I get to teach my younger ones, my younger siblings, what I've learned so far. And so we are taught just a lot of values in the way that we're spending so much time on the land. So NOAA has access to 3 roads and they take you out into the country. And so we spend a lot of time out on the land, which as you can see, there aren't as many people, there aren't roads in these pictures. And so because we're very far from a store or from a hospital, it's very important to learn to be very observant and to practice avoidance of conflict. And that doesn't just mean not fighting, but it also just means being observant and being prepared and to do your part and to really listen to noises that are around you or to listen to the people that you're working together with as a way to prevent any injury or to just be able to carry yourself in a good way, because these lands are wild and we share them with other animals and we want to make sure that we're, you know, not going to startle a bear or that we're not harming the environment in any way. And so that's a little bit about my subsistence values that I was growing up with. Are there any questions so far?
I did have a question about the berries that you pick. I would imagine that you have a lot of different recipes that you might use. Do you usually make jam with them or do you use them in other ways?
Yeah, that's a great question. So berries are, you can use them in all sorts of ways. You could definitely make jam, and I do a lot of baking, so it's really nice to be able to add berries to different kind of desserts or pancakes or muffins, or we have something that's called like a blueberry delight, which is similar to a cheesecake, but you can highlight different berries in that dessert. And we also have Iñuraaq, which is like a Inupiaq or Inuit ice cream, where you mix the berries together. And if you have access to it, you could use tallow, which is the grated fat from different animals like caribou or moose, and you whip that up with water and it almost turns to like Cool Whip or whipped cream, and you add the berries in. And if you don't have that, you can use Crisco. That's what some people also use in making that dessert.
I think that sounds really good, actually. I noticed that there were a lot of different kinds of berries in the picture that you had of berry picking with your friends, and I was able to cross off a whole bunch of things on my bingo card. So that was, it was, but I also find that the berries have such different colors that they're very pretty as well in terms of just the photographs that you've been taking.
Yeah, thank you. Berries are also really high in nutrients and vitamins. And so that's part of where their really rich colors is indicating how healthy they are for us.
I remember that one of our other speakers, Lance Kramer, was talking about the nutritious value of some of the native foods that are collected during subsistence gathering. And so I would imagine that that's part of the knowledge that is passed down from you to your younger siblings or from your grandmother to you.
Yeah, thank you. If there are any questions anymore, I can go on to the next section.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So I went to school at the University of Hawaii Manoa, and I first went in 2013. And I was so fortunate because I really loved learning and I really loved being in Hawaii. As I mentioned, I grew up with all of these values and this relationship to the land that I knew. And when I went off to college, although it was very different, I was able to really connect with people because our values as Inuit and as Inupiaq are, a lot of them are universal values. So when you lead with your values and the way that you want to connect to people in good ways, you'll see that many people share the values, even if they're from very different parts of the country or the world. And although they may have different backgrounds than you, it really becomes like a real strong basis for connecting. And so when I went to Hawaii, I was very fortunate to learn about the Native Hawaiians and the way that they are real intentional about sharing their culture and reviving their language and their spiritual practices. So this photo was actually on campus, and the Hawaiian community has a very strong sovereignty movement in which they are very advocate for their independence, and that comes from their deep history for thousands of years on and being in Hawaii and maintaining a really good relationship with their land and their spiritual elements that they coexist with. And so I was able to learn just so much while I was going to school there. Here's a photo of the Hawaiian palace. And so Hawaii was its independent nation, and they had a monarchy similar to England does. And they were overthrown in the end of 1893. And so in my studies, I got to learn a lot about the history of the place of Hawaii. So I studied political science and ethnic studies. And ethnic studies, our slogan for our program was "Our History, Our Way." So I really got to learn a different history about the people of Hawaii and their connection to their land and their subsistence practices and how they revived their culture despite having the U.S. now be the operating power there. And so they have a very complex history and a very rich culture that I was very fortunate to learn more about. And because I come from a subsistence culture, it was very easy to make real genuine connections. So the photo on the right is of a farm. And so since the environment is so different in Hawaii, they do a lot of farming. They also do fishing. And so I was real keen to be respectful of their traditions and of how they have a relationship to their land and how their environment is so different. You know, it's so warm and you spend a lot of time in the ocean, and to really understand that connection more deeply was really beautiful and really enriching. And so I was really fortunate to just be able to like be in a really beautiful environment, to be around so many people who are just so proud of where they came from and really wanted to share their history. And that really inspired me to think about, well, how do I want to share my history as a Inupiaq and Alaska Native woman? And what does our history look like in Alaska? Because I didn't have an opportunity to learn about it in depth in school. So I always had these questions of, well, what's something similar in Alaska? And how is this different back home? And so I also was able to learn a lot about the way that Hawaiians are real proud of their sacred places. So in this photo, we're actually Hawaiians were protecting one of their most sacred mountains, Mauna Kea, from further development. And it's amazing to understand how we have spiritual power and honor natural places, and to understand how they impact environment. So Mauna Kea is so big, which is on the Big Island, that it creates the weather around it. And so, you know, NOAA, of course, studies the ocean and the weather, and to be able to have Indigenous knowledge brought into that understanding can really enrich what we know as of science. Are there any questions so far?
Thanks for that section. That was very interesting. And yes, I want to encourage people to write in your questions if you have any. I did want to make a connection between some of the things that you were talking about previously. So one of the things that you had talked about in your previous section was looking at learning about all of the subsistence resources that you collect, the berries and the salmon and moose, and learning about the life cycle of those different resources. And it strikes me that a lot of what your community does is stewardship of your lands and of your resources. And that kind of connects to what you were talking about with protecting the lands that are of significance to you. And I feel like that's one of the ways that Indigenous knowledge can really connect with NOAA's research as well, because I feel like the two types of knowledge really complement each other and can help create a larger picture of what's going on, because you had made the point that your people have been living a subsistence lifestyle for thousands and thousands of years, and that knowledge is very deep and very long term. And so I feel like the changes that we're seeing more recently in Alaska are probably some things that community members can relate back to how different they are from when they were growing up. And I was wondering whether you had heard any of those stories in your own communities about changes more recently in your communities.
Yeah, definitely. I think, as you mentioned, NOAA and other organizations can definitely work hand in hand with Indigenous people when we come together with the respect of the knowledge that Indigenous people have, and that it's based on our own science of observation for thousands of years and having a very intimate relationship with our environment. And so, for example, our elders in the Bering Straits have been talking about climate change since the early 70s, 1970s. And so they were, because so much of our culture is based in the field, as, you know, science folk can talk about, that we're so connected to the minute changes that happen in the environment or in the ice, because in a lot of ways it really can impact whether hunters will make it home successfully or make it home safely or not. And so the rapid change of, you know, sea ice is really affecting subsistence culture, because it also impacts the migration of different animals who are very used to having the very strong, sorry, my puppy, having the ice to be able to lay on, like walrus, for example. And so many of our communities in the Bering Strait still hunt walrus, but because of the ice, the pack ice being so much further north, it really makes it a lot harder for our hunters, because they have to go much further. And with, you know, the price of oil and gas, that can be really, there can be barriers to practicing our cultures. And so we have a vested interest in really wanting to understand the environment as it changes, to also be able to adapt.
Yes, several of our previous presenters had talked about safety on the ice and changes that have been happening. I know that Maya Lucan, when she gave a presentation back in February, she was talking about the safety, how the ice is not as thick as it used to be, and that can mean that you can't hunt for seals at the same time or travel along rivers during the winter. And I'm sure that changes things quite a bit in terms of your ability to move around.
Yeah, definitely. We certainly think of the ice and the water as being, you know, uniting elements that allow us to go from place to place. And so there's certainly a high level of safety that comes with needing to be observant of the thickness of ice. But I can hop back into my presentation.
we have one more question from Harry and Elizabeth from Dena'ina Lands. They were wondering whether you found similar methods of preserving food in Hawaii to Kaiana.
Oh yeah, that's a great question. So they dry fish as well. Their method is a little bit different. They use some salt, similar to how we'll brine our fish. But they, instead of having, you know, like how we have drying racks, they could just build boxes and have like a screen over it. And because it's so hot there, things will just dry in the box with the screen. they don't need to rely on coastal wind as much as we do. And they also smoke their meat. They hunt for pigs. And so they'll make smoked meat similar to how we'll make smoked salmon or drying our seal or our moose meat for jerky. So it was fun to be able to share those similarities, and people get so excited talking about food and sharing food in the ways that because it's so good. And even if it's a little different, you know, like in Hawaii there's a lot of different cultures there, and they have, you know, just access to a lot of different foods or spices or vegetables. So to be able to share food together is such a great way to be able to learn about culture and just different ways to prepare things.
That's great. Harry and Elizabeth were also wondering whether there were similar ways of naming children in memory of someone who's passed, or whether if that's similar to in Alaska Native culture.
Yeah, there's definitely a really high value on naming. I don't know if it's similar so much in like the way that they pass names on to honor people. They definitely honor their land and their like gods in their names. So I think a lot, from my understanding, a lot of the names are more honoring places or the gods. And there probably are relationships too, but the way that their language is formatted is like, some people will have real long Hawaiian names. And so it'll be like almost a whole sentence will be their name, and that like the names kind of tell a story. And so they also will like dream about names. And that's also how you could learn, because you know, our dreams are so sacred and connect us to another realm of knowing. And so there's some similarities and some differences, but it's always fun to learn and talk about that with people.
And then we have one more question about how you decided what you wanted to study in university when you went to college.
Yeah, so in school, I liked social studies. So when I first went to Hawaii, I started taking like history classes, and I started taking intro to political science and intro to ethnic studies. And they just really helped to, so political science really explains the systems of power that we find ourselves. And that could be the systems of government or the systems of money, or why education is laid out a certain way, or who has power to make decisions, and how people also don't have power. And so political science really helped to explain my experiences growing up as an Indigenous person that didn't know my language. And so it really helps to understand how ideas can be turned into policy, and then those policies turn into law, and then those laws are enacted and carried out in certain ways. And so to me, it was really empowering to be able to learn that. And then alongside of understanding how power works and how power can be given back to communities, my ethnic studies program really talked about the histories of Black people, of Native Americans, of Native Hawaiians, of Filipinos in Hawaii, and Chinese in Hawaii, and Koreans, and like this really big breadth of knowledge that was focused in communities of color, which I didn't have access to learning about prior to that. And so those two things together made me feel just really empowered to interrogate, where is my power? What is my power as an Indigenous woman? And what is my story? And how have I not learned things, but how could I continue to learn them and to share them out? And so that was why I had chosen my programs of study in college. And I felt so motivated to then continue my education. And I received a master's also from the University of Hawaii in Indigenous politics. And that really just was a deeper learning of how Native people enact sovereignty, how we enact power in our relationships, in our relationships to land. And power isn't so much something that is something you wield over, but it was more of like, how do Native people practice relationship? How do we practice with outsiders, and how do we practice our relationship to our animals that we live with, and how do we practice our relationship to the environment that we're a part of? And so that was part of why I studied the things that I did, and it was always so enriching. So thank you. Wonderful question.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's go to your next section, and then we'll see whether there are any other questions after that.
Yeah, so my Inupiaq values, I took them with me. They gave me a very strong foundation from which I stood on, to be real humble and to be brave and to work hard. And so I channeled those things, and I traveled a lot. I was very fortunate because I was a part of scholarships that I had extra funding to be able to travel. Here I was in Washington, D.C. with some Gwich'in natives from interior, and we were advocating for the protection of Arctic from any further lease development. And I also went to Canada and was a part of a convening of Inuit from Alaska, Canada, and a Sami representative from Norway. And all this talking about the ways that we are so proud of our cultural identities, that how are we strengthening that across community? And I also studied abroad when I was in college, and this was a great way to be able to see the world in a way that I felt was safe, because I traveled with my a cohort from my school. So I studied in Spain, but I had traveled in various parts of Europe. So I'm in Spain, in Ireland, in France, in Hungary, in these photos. In these ones, I was in Italy, in Portugal, in Switzerland. We also went to Africa. So we are in Chefchaouen, which is this beautiful blue city in Morocco, and Tangier, which is more, we were on the beach riding camels, which was just so much fun. And here's a little bit more Portugal, London, and Paris. And so my values had like given me just so much strength that even when I was in new spaces and I was like real scared and it was real different, I at least knew how to carry myself, and that I at least had the confidence that I knew how to make good relationships. And that's really what made me feel safe when I was in new places, and safe enough to feel brave to go try new things. And that, you know, I was so lucky to have a very supportive family and a very supportive community and a very supportive culture that I felt brave enough to go across the world and to go to different continents and try lots of different things. And it was just fun. And our people as Indigenous people, we traveled a lot. You know, we used to have skin boats and we would voyage and we'd make relationship with people, and we're still doing that. And so there's so much fun to be able to see the world and to know that home will always be there. And the people we love will be there when we come back, and we can share our stories when we're there. Are there any questions?
Yeah, we had Bob was going back to your last section where you're talking about your knowledge, what you were learning when you were in college, and he wanted to know, how would you like to use your knowledge, the knowledge that you've gained?
Yeah, so I'm doing a presentation right now as just a way to speak a little bit about my knowledge. Professionally, I work as a communications director for Native Movement, and Native Movement is a grassroots organization that supports Indigenous sovereignty and a just transition, which is just a transition from our economy to being more equitable and just in practicing a sustainable way of life, which is inherent to Native people in Alaska and across the world. It's a way that we always were in relationship. And so I also am a poet, and that's how I share my knowledge too, is through my poetry and through storytelling. And a little bit more in the presentation, I'll talk about some more of like my community work.
And then Mike from Florida had a question about the dots that you have on your face and was wondering what they symbolize.
Oh yeah, that's also in my presentation. They're traditional Inuit tattoos. And so our face tattoos are markings that connect us to our ancestors and to our spirituality as Native people across the Arctic. So I'm happy to share more in my presentation.
Well, let's go on to our next section then.
Okay. So I came back to Alaska after all my travels and after college, and I wanted to just really immerse myself deeper into what it means to be an Indigenous woman. And so I did that through cultural pageants, and we have them at our local level in Nome. And then I was also participated in WIO, which is the, their new name is World Exhibition of Indian Olympics or Indigenous Olympics. And that's held in Fairbanks every year in Dinaka and Gwich'in lands in the interior of Alaska. And the cultural pageant really helped to highlight our cultural skills and knowledge as Indigenous women, and to really help us to think about what's our responsibility to our tribe and what's our responsibility to our community as becoming young leaders. And so different from a beauty pageant, cultural pageants really highlight the cultural knowledge that we have and the cultural skills, and it becomes a setting to which we share that. And so there's like a talent portion, an interview question session, and in the photo we're highlighting our traditional regalia. And part of understanding our traditional regalia is the ways that hard work and ingenuity is built into everything that we have as Indigenous people, and it's seen in our clothing. And these are all sustainably harvested, and you know, there's so much intricacy and brilliance and ingenuity that goes into something as simple as a mitten or hat or a parka or our mukluks. And so it's just this wonderful space to be able to really highlight our cultures. And so I was very fortunate to win Miss WIO, and very humble to be able to, I remained humble in honoring that I was representing WIO, and I was also representing my family, and I was representing my communities that I come from, and that really my community was uplifting me, just like in this photo of the Nalukatuk, the blanket toss, and that was at Kutnoot, which is a trading festival in Kotzebue. I was very honored to be able to participate in the games there and to help with the cultural pageant that happened in Kotzebue, which was Miss Arctic Circle and Miss Teen Arctic Circle. And so as I've come back to Alaska, I really wanted to learn more about our subsistence practices that I didn't grow up around. And so, for example, this was me learning how to make seal oil out of the blubber of an ugruk, which is a bearded seal. And this was the second one that my brother had harvested. His first one had gone to an elder, and that's a practice that, you know, the first anything that you receive or you make, you gift to an elder as a way to really honor those that have come before us and have taught us. And so I'm always learning. I'm always hungry to learn more about the ways that we practice our culture, what it means to practice our culture now as things are changing. So here I was ladling the seal oil into jars so I could give out to family and to really share, because that was the first time I had made it. And as I mentioned, I also learned more about Inuit tattooing, and that's a practice that we have done for thousands of years across Alaska and across the Arctic. And traditionally we did skin poke or skin sewing, and the tattoos are in many places on your body. It was considered a rite of passage and a ceremony that really marked kind of a coming of age of Indigenous women and Indigenous men, and Two-Spirit also participated in tattoos, but I could only speak from my experience as an Indigenous woman. But there's a very strong revival of Indigenous knowledge and Indigenous practices that I'm very happy to be a part of, and really proud that I can grow up, or I can, as I grow up, I have felt like I've earned my markings, and that I also get to carry myself with them, and younger generations can grow up seeing them and it be very natural and normal as it once was. And so I've also learned how to make kulix, or a seal oil lamp. And I did this in a community setting. We were having a workshop on it, and you know, so much of my knowledge I know is not mine. It was shared with me, and it's my responsibility to keep sharing it. And so as I learned the kulik, I also felt so excited to be able to share. The kulik is a traditional seal oil lamp. We used them for lighting in our homes. We used them for ceremony and for heating and cooking. So I've learned that so much of our culture has, of course, it's beautiful and important, but it also served a function. And so much of bringing things back is also understanding the function of things that served the purpose of why we had these things like ceremony, or why we had tattooing, and really understanding not just the what or the how, but also the why. And so I'm continuously learning how to, you know, practice my culture or to learn my language, and really just feeling so much motivation to be able to share that with others, because I was so generous in being able to receive these teachings. And the most fun way to learn is with other people, and to enjoy that process and to share that process. And so that concludes my presentation. You're welcome to learn more about me and some of the skills and passions that I have at my website. And I also have a email, but I also have, you know, I think we have about 10 more minutes for time. And if anyone made bingo.
I actually think I just made bingo on that last, on the last section that you did. There was a question about, when you were talking about cultural pageants, whether each candidate makes their own regalia, and what does that involve, or what did that involve for you?
Yeah, so Making regalia is a huge feat. So I personally haven't, I didn't make the regalia that I had worn. I was actually, one of my family members had shared it with me for that pageant. I think that was similar for a lot of the participants. But that's definitely like an element that I want to continue learning is skin sewing. There's definitely a lot of patience that's required in doing that type of skill. But I think there's, you know, lots of people to learn from, and I have a lot of time to keep learning.
I was also thinking that you had said that you had had a video that you wanted to show of the blanket toss. So I was wondering.
Thank you for that reminder. It's a little hard to see. Oh, this isn't the one. I'm learning this new program of how we host meetings in this system. So thank you for the reminder. Can folks see it?
So how high do you get when you're tossed with the blanket like that, or with the walrus skin?
You know, I'm not too sure. Probably at least like 6, maybe 8 feet, maybe 10. Like if they really pull you up high, it's a little scary. So I've never really thought about how high I actually go so I could keep doing it.
How old were you when you first started?
I hadn't done it until I went to WIO. So that was one of my first times. Sometimes they do it as like community games in Nome, but I had just never tried. So it wasn't until I was probably in my early 20s. Some folks start a lot younger, you know, but you know, you're never too old to keep learning and trying new things.
We have Kathleen from Kiana is listening in, and so she just wanted to let you know that she's listening from Kiana. And I was actually wondering what other when you have a talent portion of the cultural pageant, were things like blanket toss part of the talent, or was that the cultural part?
That was actually a part of the WIO games. And so one of the competitions is the Nalakatuk, the blanket toss. And so I was trying to compete. You get judged on if you do any tricks or how high you jump and if you land. So there's a intricate point system, but I just thought it would be really fun to try. But for the talent portion, one woman really stood out to me. She brought a caribou leg and showed us which ligament of the caribou that you use to make sinew, which is the you dry it and it becomes a thread, and it's like waxed thread, but it's waterproof. And so traditionally we use sinew when we were doing sewing for anything that could be in water, because it wouldn't it would be waterproof. So she had taken the whole big caribou leg out, and that one was probably like the coolest talent portion that I had seen. I had sung a song in Inupiaq and Hawaiian and talked about spirituality and reclaiming my name as Iñuraaq and the spiritual all the spiritual importance of that.
Sounds like you can learn a lot from just even participating as well as watching the pageants.
Yeah.
I did have one final question for you, which is that if you had if you had any pieces of advice that you'd give to our students that are watching today, elementary, middle school, high school students, from your own experience?
Yeah, I think for youth, what's so important is just to know that you are enough just as you are, that you are special and unique. And while it might be real easy to compare yourself in the talents other people have, it's so important to honor what comes naturally to you, because those are gifts from creation and from our ancestors. And just cultivating our own strengths and our own gifts and being able to share them is what will really just have your life be fun and enriching. And yeah, that's what I'd like to share.
Well, thank you so much for sharing your presentation with us today and sharing your culture's values. And I think that we all learned a lot from your presentation today. I really appreciate you joining us. And for those of you in the audience, thank you for coming and attending our webinar. And we will be taking a week break next week, and then we'll come back with some webinars on that are focused on the North Slope. So thank you very much. Thank you, Iñuraaq, and we will say goodbye for now. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.